I would be inviting the guest panelists. First of all, I would like to invite architect Shamit Manchanda, who serves as the co-founder of Manchanda Associates and Architects. He is a member of Council of Architecture and chairman of Northern Chapter of Indian Institute of Architects and Indian Confederation of Healthcare Accreditation. So he would be the moderator for the session, architect Manchanda.
Good afternoon, fellow professionals. It's a very interesting panel that we have today, architects, engineers, certification experts. We hope to have a very interesting discussion on fire safety. Fire, as we all know, is one of the five basic elements of creation. And while on one hand it is a source of energy, fire can destroy and destroy completely. One of the biggest fears any consultant has is that your own building should never catch fire. Though we cannot ensure that, but we can surely go a long way in mitigating that. One of the issues with fire safety has been post-occupancy misuse, which happens. Though you have all the best intent to make a building fire safe, what the owners or the occupiers do at a later stage, as Professor Sa said, the fire door has been installed, it has a panic bar, all the right things have been done, but somebody comes and puts a padlock on it, and it is absolutely rendered useless. The fire escape routes become stores, and there is no means of egress from that building. So to cover all these aspects, and starting with what our codes talk about, I'm going to pose a few questions to our panelists one by one, and later after that we can have a open discussion on this issue. I'll start with Mr. Ashok Khurana. I would like him to talk about the initiatives taken by BIS and give us a broad overview on the fire code as defined under the NBC.
Thank you, everyone. No, I'm not going to talk too much about the BIS or NBC. Main reason is NBC, as you are all well literate in that part, what is the designing features have been discussed. Main reason, the buildings, even though designed, still fail in the case of fire, is one is the misuse. And before coming here, for last few days, I have had deep discussion with my friends in US and Canada and how they are taking care of the misuse. Because a third party check and all those things go haywire later on. What solution, what I have understood and I have come forward is the insurance. Every building should be insured for the fire every year. And the insurance people get it checked and certified of all misuses from the third party, from their registered inspectors, and then it is renewed. So that can assure to a large extent that misuse is minimized. Otherwise, third party, what is happening in India, everything is inspected, but something extra comes up. As in the Lalit Hotel, the top floor, new construction, which was all temporary, it is a failure of temporary construction. It was not a failure of the main building fire. Main building did not catch the fire. It is a top floor, which was a temporary construction. How did it come up? If it was to be insured, insurance company would have been in the soup. All these claims would have gone to transferred to the insurance company, and the bad name of the insurance company, and the person, inspector, was appointed by the insurance company would have been in the soup, and they should be liable. All these inspectors should be liable for the personal suits, both civil and criminal. Unless these massive changes in our thinking and system is made, that fire safety, we may design, will not upkeep it because it is not on the priority. It costs money to everyone in the building. To the hotel also, its cost of money is the least priority. What we have seen, even everything has been provided, the sprinklers don't work. Zang lag gaya system ko. Simple word, system ko zang lag gaya because we are not operating, we are not maintaining it. That's how that zang lag gaya, that will come out. Because every year it's being tested and by the third party, and third party insurance companies can't afford that the fires go, continuous fires are occurring and they are losing the money. Now in the case of the London case, the main feature was the providing of the wrong material. We are trying to ensure that the right material is being put into the place. For that is the awareness. I had done about 10 years back, lot of buildings in the Bombay. At that time we had provided ACP with the mineral core and all those specifications. Awareness at Bombay, and when I came to Delhi, there is awareness is zero. I've been trying very hard because Delhi is lagging behind Bombay in all fields, including fire safety, at least by 10 years. Why? Thinking also, there is a building which has a good high plaza in Bombay at 10 meters. Only one approach is of the fire tenders. Architect, my friend, took me there and showed me. Only the fire tenders will go to that plaza. Otherwise, it's all walkable. All slopes are totally banked. Something new which we can't think in Delhi, and something new which our fire people will not approve in Delhi. No, my fire tender, my fire ladder can't go up. The misuse is spoiling. Even if your fire ladder goes, the misuse is spoiling. You people are not able to exit because the fire exits have been closed. Mr. Shah has dealt it very nicely. Misuse is spoiling. We have to take care of that. And for that, we have to think of wild thinking. You know, this signature bridge was designed in my room at that time. And one of the top architect cum engineers of the world. Sitting here, both the people are working out their forces also, design shape also. It has dream has come true today. The vision being, we didn't have experience of that SQ. Simple, instead of signature bridge, simple bridge, because the CM at that time, she wanted that something special has to be there. Now everybody is taking credit, but that time taking that decision was of the prime importance. Now, everything was imported from most other things from China, and we didn't have the erections. Bridges were not available to carry out that load, but things have happened. What I mean to say is that where is there a willingness, we can go ahead. But willingness should be in the right direction. So I would request that think of those things, how this can be, misuse can be done away with. Now the fire dampers are there after the Upar's tragedy. And another thing which I have seen missing is the detailing. One of my friend in the second, the last one, the presentation, he said that gap, which is right. But who is providing that gap? Why is not being detailed between the, with the glazing and the floor? Why it is not being detailed? How the builder comes into the picture? If the details were there, building, he has not provided, why the fire clearance has come? Fire clearance has also come. That gap is existing. If that detail was existing, the fire people would have seen that. If this is something is missing. All the materials are there, but all the materials have to be put in position. That the gap, and he talked about the gap in the partition wall between that. But that material, what we have got available in India, is not more than 20 meters. It can't expand, it can't be stand. So we should see that our floor slopes are proper. I don't have a 50 mm slope and then they say, well, this is a straight gap. 50 mm material, filling material is not there with me in India. So these key points, Everything is done very well, but the gap has not been filled, gaps have not been covered, will create the disaster. Radiation is a big point, and it, because of radiation, that bombing was, New York bombing was successful. Because of radiation only, the collapse of the building had taken place. It's not the fire, it caught the fire. Fire increased the temperature, and the steel went away. And that thing, I think, we have limited in National Building Code, the limit to which the steel structures can be there. So we should go for the composite material. We should think at the beginning itself. Anything more?
Most of the very interesting thing that you talked about is the matter of insurance. And once insurance comes into play, the owners have to cough up money for the yearly insurance premium. And if the companies refuse to give them insurance at cheaper rates, the owners will start complying with fire safety issues. A lot of things that you talked about are also part of the code. Do you think it should be made mandatory?
Yes, code should be made, and people have, Delhi has adopted already. All the fire provisions, and some other cities have, municipal corporation, Delhi has adopted, notifications was issued by the LG. So everyone should adopt those codes. And it has been given, and there is no stoppage in revising. What Mr. Shah pointed out, that deficiencies and other thinking. What I always say, at least do something first today. Tomorrow you will be able to improve. Don't dream of the best part today. The moment you dream, you will not be able to achieve. 10 years you will pass, you will not do anything. You will be fighting for the best. The best is the enemy of the better, and go for the best, better one, jo humare paas hai. And then they start the improving, and it should must be made compulsory. Not only for this purpose, it should be made compulsory for the import of materials. Conformity should be there to the NBC of the import of materials. I am the chairman of the CED5 in with the tile flooring. The conformity has been made compulsory. That's why we are not today seeing lot of made in China tiles in India. So those type of that is to be done by Ministry of Commerce. So if we take up with the Ministry of Commerce also the conformity, we will not have the cheap materials imported from the foreign countries.
Another thing that you mentioned was that the use of cladding and mineral core for ACP, which you did in Bombay. Has anything been done? Do we have any codes in India? Which Grenfell was one of the reasons for the Grenfell Towers fire was the core was polyethylene and not mineral core. Are there any codes available in India?
No, in the my committee only the CED5. We have been with this all ACP manufacturers trying to work out a code. Main reason has been the whenever I talk with the say this firewall, testing is by the ISO. And ISO refers to the 10 codes further behind. So that adoption is become, and ISO codes are very costly, people don't buy. If one code I adopt, the 10 reference codes will be there, so you will be ending up at buying 10 codes, which nobody buys. So we are working out, I had gone to the factories and working out a system, with especially with the IIT also, that we have our own Indian system available for the testing. In India, testing labs are there. And I think it will be soon, in a year or so, you will find the code. Draft code will be out in another 6 months, where you can give the comments, and all those rating hours will be there. And my next endeavor is to have the installation code, because it's not the end of material. Installation is very important. So the installation code will come.
Thank you, sir. My next question is going to be to Mr. Gaurav Srivastava, who is from IIT Gandhinagar. Could you just highlight on what is being done at the college levels, at the IIT level, in teaching the upcoming technocrats and students who will be serving the industry on fire safety codes?
So I'll start by mentioning a few things that are happening at IIT Gandhinagar. So perhaps we are the only IIT which has a multidisciplinary center called Center for Safety Engineering. And the focus of this center is primarily to promote a culture of safety in India and outside India, and to make sure that you know, our present and future becomes safer. Okay. There are several focus areas of this center. One of them is fire, and so fire is one of the major initiatives. We are also looking partly at process safety and you know, linking cognitive science and learning behaviors. And linking that with how accidents can be prevented or how fires can be prevented. This center organizes or keeps organizing several short courses which are open to all students, professionals, academicians, focusing on a variety of topics related to fire safety. We have developed a full-scale fire testing facility which is a three-story structure. Specifically for testing cladding materials and facade systems with some sponsorship from the underwriters' laboratories. So this is again the only such facility in India. It is not available anywhere else. And we have done 6-7 tests so far. We also did a mock-up test of the Grenfell building tower using the same kind of materials. So aluminum composite panels, and inside there was an insulation material of PIR, polyisocyanurate. And the kind of fire behaviors that we observed and the post-fire investigations were actually pretty much similar to what was observed at Grenfell. So at IIT Gandhinagar, we have invested heavily on understanding the science behind fire safety. And we believe that only if we understand the science properly can we promote practices which will ensure fire safety. We also have inducted some fire safety and safety related courses in our curriculum. So for example, there is an undergraduate course on fire dynamics, which teaches the basics of fire, how it behaves in fluids. There is a course on structural design for fire safety, which considers design of reinforced concrete and steel structural systems when they are subjected to fire. So there are these kind of things. So we are trying to incorporate these things into our curriculum. We are trying to organize short courses, workshops, hands-on training, big and small level fire tests to understand the overall landscape to enhance fire safety.
Thank you, sir. Very heartening to know that we have a center for fire safety which has come up and doing a lot of research. Could you tell us a bit more about the testing facilities that you have set up at Gandhinagar?
So as of now, we have three levels of testing facilities. One is the material level test. So this involves using standard equipment like a cone calorimeter or thermogravimetry analysis or you know, differential scanning calorimetry. So these are typical fingerprinting tests which are done on materials which have a potential for combustion. And by doing these tests, one can conclusively say whether material A would burn more than material B and things like those under different conditions. So these are typical fingerprinting experiments used for all you know, fire testing fire materials which are prone to fire. The second scale of test is an intermediate scale test, where we go from the material level to a slightly larger level. So if I give an example of a facade system, we will consider a full ACP, for example, an aluminum composite panel. And this panel will be subjected to varying level of heat incidence fluxes, which is controlled through computer-controlled heaters. And there we observe what are the temperatures, what are the, you know, when does it catch fire and things like these. And the largest scale is the full-scale facility that we have, where we actually are able to do three stories worth of full-scale fire tests. So a typical fire test would be like, we will install the entire facade system. So this level of test will take care of not only materials but also installation methods, which also play an extremely important role in the overall fire behavior. So we will install the entire three-story facade structure as per actuals. Inside the compartments, we will furnish it with using actual office furniture. So for example, we will place tables, chairs, reception desks, things like those. We will create a fire scenario, which is likely, for example, in that particular kind of a building or that kind of setting.
We will start a fire at the ground floor and then we will let it grow. And then through an extensive set of instrumentation, through thermocouples for measuring temperatures and for video cameras and infrared imagery.
We would see how the fire behaves, how it moves up or sideways on the facade system, how the upper floors would interact with the facade fire. So for example, ground floor fire goes to facade system, it goes up, and now this facade fire of the first floor now will begin to interact with the first compartment, which would have otherwise been unfired, but because of the facade fire on the window, it will, the interior of the room may begin to catch fire. So these are the three levels of test facilities that we have developed. But of course, this is not the end of it. We have future plans of developing an FPA 285 testing facility for the facade systems, which is one of the leading standards when it comes to facade fire safety, and of course of other similar kind of things.
Thank you. It's good to know that we have our own fire testing systems, and I'm sure this will give a lot of inputs to what Mr. Khurana is doing and CED5 to help him set up the standards at BIS. I will now move to Architect Charanjit Shah. He has been involved with a lot of airport projects, multimodal transport hubs, which have drastically changed over the last 8 or 10 years. What used to be a very simple airport or a railway station, today we have very interesting buildings coming up. So I would like him to share with us some of the challenges an architect faces in terms of designing these kind of structures.
No, I would rather say that in Indian context, we are totally equipped with all information, all technology, everything put together. And as rightly said by Mr. Khurana, the Bibles are there. Not that we can always revisit them, but the only thing is that we do everything put together very professionally. Today we talk about many things, maybe like intelligent building management system. There are a lot of other things happening. But when, after doing all that, when it really comes to the execution and how do you do the project management and how the you are inspecting, maybe it is direct or third party, whatever you call it, during the construction, we find so many, when you talk about very large projects, there are so many loopholes, like, sometimes the air conditioning doesn't work. And then what happens, the air from one compartment to another compartment is going through the shafts, and those are not sealed. So that is, when the air conditioning cannot work, how the firefighting will work? Because all those air conditioning ducts and other shafts need to be absolutely 100% compartmentalized, but that is not happening. So these are certain, things which are to be looked into, and probably here we are facing problem, as Mr. Khurana has said, that it is the social aspect, how we socially grow, how we maintain. It's like in Bombay, you said, rightly said, that people have a little more discipline. And even on road, you go to south, even culture is very good. But here, I don't know, we in the north, we have very harsh culture. Ki yaar, main nikal jau, piche banda mar jaye. That approach, the social science has to work. We need to be aware that how we really interact, how we do all those things together. So they are probably, all these incidents which are happening is all encroachments. And the probably all the technocrats or we fulfill our role to the extent which is required in a building in terms of approval, in terms of making it absolutely sensitive to the fire protection. But when it comes to governance, it comes to, you know, from the government authorities, when you come to approval, other things do not happen. Perhaps there we all know how things are going on. So that is where, as he has very rightly said, one thing is the insurance, you know, fire insurance, where there will be automatically a third party audit, automatically third party intervention, which will look into it because of money. And because he's going to insure it, it means that it will be adhering to all our codes, maybe NBC or other, you know. So that is a very good thing, you know, which I think it has to be made mandatory. Any building which is more than 5,000 square meters or something like 10,000 square meters or anything of that nature has to be mandatory. And any public building needs that sort of insurance. So that is very good, you know. I will not take time because we have many more panelists. And these are some things, you know, which I think we need to really understand. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'll now move to architect Sushant Verma. Grenfell Towers highlighted facades play a big role in propagation of fire. What, according to you, are the kind of materials and designs that would you recommend for facades to enable better fire safety?
Yeah, so I think before I, you know, get on to that point of the kind of materials and techniques that we can use, I'd like to, you know, point out the basic issues that we have here, which most of the other people have also mentioned about the consciousness and the awareness issues that are there right now. And it is not only with, you know, the builders or the government, it is with the architects and the users as well. It is pretty much all of us who are using the building. You know, I think a very good example Sridhar had given before was about the cars, you know, how we look into the safety of cars. I had this discussion with one of, you know, the collaborative architects we were working with, you know, about an aeroplane, you know, like how in an airplane the safety norms are followed and how all of us are following that, but we don't see that in a building. For example, if I ask you, you know, get on an airplane where the safety equipment will not be there, there will be only two crew members instead of five, would you be comfortable, you know, taking that flight? Possibly not, but we do that in buildings. We are okay to, you know, inhabit buildings which are not compliant with the norms that the government is setting out as well. So I think it's the sensitivity of the users as well. We need to decide and we need to, you know, put a foot down and say that we will not use the buildings which are not following the norms, first thing. Even for the architects, so as a design studio, we work in collaboration with various architects and provide them design technology consultancy. So over there, most of the architects come to us for, let's say, you know, the aesthetics of things or how we can, you know, parametrically design facades and stuff. We do a lot of facades. And they try to restrict us, our roles to design part of it. And we often come up with questions like, what will happen when the fire happens? You know, why aren't we doing enough of research and R&D into the material sciences as well? I think those are things that in India we have to, you know, start looking into. And I think rightly pointed out by Mr. Srivastava as well about the safety, you know, education norms and stuff to educate people about safety. That is very important for architects as well. I come across so many architects who we're working with and we tell them, you know, 6 meters is what we need to leave for fire tender, and they would say, okay, let's have the facade coming out a little more, we'll landscape that later. So that kills the whole point, you know. So it's the you know, the intention of the architects as well a lot of times. And in terms of materials, I think we are very, very, you know, far behind the materials that we should be using. An example I will give you, for example, right now we're talking of, you know, a fireproof material. We should also start to look into a fire extinguishing material, for example. Now that might sound very absurd, you know, but right now is the time that we need to start thinking of things like facades should not even just stop fire. What if we have facades which can actually help extinguish fires? There are new, you know, products, I don't know if that's out in the market, but there's a lot of videos online about there's this fire extinguishing ball which you throw into the fire and gives a blast and extinguishes the fire. Why can't we think of such things in architecture as well? But of course, it will require a lot of research and development. So that needs to be streamlined. We need to put our focus onto the research part as well. And yeah, I mean, a good detailing should always you know, help out.
Interesting, you talked about the need for research and newer materials. You worked abroad. Can you talk about fire codes that are existing in high urban density areas like New York or other places, and how they can be implemented in India? Could you shed some light on that?
I think the fire norms, pretty much we are in line with the fire norms that are followed internationally as well. So I don't see a much of a lag in terms of the norms that are being set in India, comparing it with what is happening globally as well. It's about how much we are able to follow them. A lot of times we think of you know, falling with these norms as an additional cost,
which I think is a problem of you know, again, the mentality of looking at that,
how important that is. You know, as has been rightly pointed out, that the life is most important at the end of the day of the inhabitants. So that is something that we have to look into. In terms of norms, I think pretty much most of the norms that we have in India are in line with the global norms that we have. But at the same time, that is evolving, and it's kind of, we are at a good time right now to evolve these things with so many incidents kind of happening in the last few years. So I think it's about the application of these norms rather than the norms, because most of the norms are not being able to follow. I think we also mentioned about, you know, interior designers and decorators and their roles as well. A lot of times they will end up using materials which are not compliant with the fire safety norms. How do we stop that? So that will need a lot of, I don't know, you know, like lobbying of the material community or something to stop that effort, because everything comes down to cost. So a designer at the end of the day is not paid enough to detail something out, so they will do it very loosely. So at the end, it all comes down to, you know, like who is at fault, and we are doing a blame game at the end of the day. So it's about compliance of you know, all the norms.
Eventually. Thanks. As you rightly said, norms are there, but we also have an issue of, this question is to Ashish Rakeja. We have different bylaws across different cities, though we have a national building code, but many cities do not implement the National Building Code, they implement their own bylaws. Could you talk about, or basically advise architects in terms of what are the good practices one should follow while designing and conceptualizing buildings?
Thank you, Shamitji. I would have said this question would have been more relevant if we did not have the new NBC. I can tell you that in last 1.5 years since the time the NBC has been out, 2 years since the NBC has been out, there's a significant change across the country that we are seeing in terms of awareness and compliance to NBC. There was an ambiguity, or we always used to say that NBC is recommendatory. When we were practicing the fire design of fire safety systems in the country, but not now. We are seeing that NBC is getting adopted in the municipal codes, and the compliance is becoming mandatory for that, and NBC is a good document. I just want to add few things here. There was a project on which we were asked to compare the fire officer there wanted that before I give an approval to something which is beyond the NBC, what is written in the NBC. Could you compare it, the various codes, and tell me that where does the building stand? When we compared the IBC, International Building Code, when we looked at the NBC, and we also looked at the NFPA, I can tell you what Sushant was also saying, we found NBC to be quite demanding, and in fact more stringent at most of the places than the other international codes. So the code is well there, is very much there. The challenge which comes is in the implementation and interpretation, and also at times the conflict with the local codes. Now, one of the cities, I wouldn't name it, we ran into a problem, like the NBC says that you have to do a smoke extract at 12 air changes per hour from the basement. One, the municipal code there, the bylaws, is still reading 15 air changes per hour and the 30 air changes per hour which was there. Now, fire officer says that, look, I know 12 air changes per hour is there, but there is an archaic code which is binding me to ask you to implement this 15 and the 30 requirement. Obviously, we finally got away with it by saying that, look, 12 is adequate, and we put it on the record on the file. But yeah, those conflicts occurred. The other issue is, as I said, that interpretations. Now, I'll give you an interesting example of it. All of us are aware the basement ventilation, we are doing 12 air changes per hour. There is an extraction mode. So you have a fan which is extracting the smoke. That fan needs to be in a 2-hour fire rated enclosure. There has to be duct passing through enclosure, has to be fire rated. And all of those things are very well defined in the code out there. And an equivalent amount of air is being supplied as a makeup air. So the system is working more of at a neutral level or a slightly negative level. Now we went to another part of the country, again without naming that, the fire officer said that, look, I prefer, I'm okay with the 12 air changes per hour, but I prefer that you do not extract, you positively pressurize the basement. So you put fresh air fans which are pumping the air into the basement, and we do that. Now interestingly, both these are acceptable standards. There is a, NBC does mention that obliquely or passively that this is also an accepted area. So the interpretations vary, like what is the material of the fire pipe? Are you going to be GI or are you going to be MS? Now some parts of the country are saying GI, they would like to use GI because in the IS there is a mention of the GI also. But most part of the country allow the MS to be there. So I would say that there are areas of disagreement, but fire officers are today much better equipped. Most of them are accepting NBC. All of them are accepting NBC. A good dialogue at an initial stage is definitely helpful to look at these idiosyncrasies which are there, some typicalities which are there in the city. But at the end of the day, NBC is a good document which is now being followed and being looked at. And I think these challenges of the other conflict, most fire officers are today understanding that the newer code should be given cognizance. So that's what my take would be, Shamitji.
Very rightly said, we have the codes in place. Could you comment on, though we have a good design intent, could you comment on post-occupancy use once it's handed over?
Well, how do I comment on that? Now, let's take the example of a car, since this is the flavor of the day right now. You have the seat belts there. If you choose not to wear the seat belts, you've chosen a path. The first is ignorance, and second is blindly closing the eye and thinking nothing is going to happen to you. If you did not know that that there is something called a seat belt, fine. Who is to be blamed? You are to be blamed. If you knew there is a seat belt and you still chose to drove the car at a speed of 100 or at a 10 or a speed of 20 and went through that the process where something happened, then who's to be blamed? Now, there was an initial discussion which was taking place. I'll give another interesting thing. There's a project that we just finished, and it's an operation mode. An audit took place. Now, audit was done by the not by the insurance agencies, because somehow I haven't found the insurance agencies who are testing this, checking the fire, because I just took an insurance, maybe of a lesser value. They did not find me of importance that they came and checked my fire systems. But having said that, it was done by the funders of that project. They said that we like our project that we have funded to be checked by a third party consultant. When they went there, they found that a car park has been designated right in front of the fire door in the basement itself. Now, if you know that there is a problem out there, if you put a car park, what am I supposed to say? Chiranjee Shah Saab showed many pictures of fire staircases being locked. Not only being locked, he also showed the things being kept there in the fire escape staircases, air handling units being, rooms being used as a storage. What are we looking for? Are we looking for somebody to come and tell us you're doing wrong when we know that is wrong? I think it's an education which has to be on a continuous basis. Every owner of the building has to be aware, go through the fire drill, is very well specified. So from my perspective, as I see, Shamit ji, the codes and standards are very clear. It's for us to follow that. I think if you are waiting for some regulation to come and tell us that what you are doing is wrong or how it should be done is unfortunate. A simple thing like operating a fire extinguisher. I can tell you that we have this fire extinguishers being used in the buildings, simple fire extinguishers. How many of us know exactly how to operate a fire extinguisher? In the case of emergency, you have to figure out how that fire extinguisher is going to operate. That's our problem. Are you expecting a CFO of a city to come and tell you how to operate a fire extinguisher? No. And I can tell you, even my wife, your family is back at your houses. It's a simple thing that we need to do that. Smoke detection system. In fact, I come from a mechanical background. My own thinking is a smoke detection system, these intelligent addressable smoke detection system, should take out 99% of the fires which are going to occur. These are intelligent enough to tell you the fire at a nascent stage. Forget about spreading, forget about stopping, forget about compartmentalizing. You can detect the fire at a very, very nascent stage with these. Just have the simple system installed and working. We find the system switched off because of X, Y, Z reasons. So, if we choose to close our eyes, if
we choose to ignore them, wait for the something to happen to us, I think nothing can be done about it.
Thanks.
Taking a cue from that, I'll move to Mr. Rizvi. How effective do you think and how reliable these protection systems are, which are designed in terms of smoke management or egress, etc.? Could you shed some light on that?
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. As far as the reliability of the protection system is concerned, I mean, this, honestly speaking, the codes are well in place, the system integrator is well in place, the installation agencies are well in place, but how good are you maintaining those systems? How well are you actually equipped to handle any sort of rectification which needs to be done in those systems, and how good you are at doing it? That is A. Now B, coming to egress. Egress is not, I mean, from my perspective, of course, we have so much learned panelists over here. I mean, the technical aspects have been beautifully touched by every one of them, and I am not the right technical person to comment upon it. But then if you really want to hashtag beat the fire, beat your mindset first. How many of us sitting over here had actually thought that there was no safety procedural briefing before the commencing of this event? Absolutely. How many of us has actually seen that there are loose wires on the floor? In case if I have to run, I might trip and it could be a more chaotic situation. Where is the fire exit over here? Have any one of us noticed that? There is a path which leads to the fire exit. It has actually been narrowed down because of, you know, of course, their operational issues. Is there any first aid hose reel kept over here? Is there any extinguisher kept over here? See, the aspect what I am trying to put across over here is not the technical aspects I am trying to put across, is the behavioral aspects. So first we change, beat the mindset. Trust me, 90% of the job to beat the fire has already been done. As Ashish ji just rightly said, have we ever actually held the extinguisher in our hand and tried to see how to use it? There are beautiful products like Sushant actually suggested. There, and you know, honestly speaking, recently I was going through one website, they're coming out with paints which are actually going to extinguish the fires. Are we ready for that? Are codal provisions ready for that? Are implementation agencies, are they going to support those aspects? Really, that time has actually come to figure those aspects out. So that's what I would like to add, sir. Thank you.
Interesting. Instead of beat the fire, beat the mindset. So that brings us to another important point, as you rightly pointed out, the importance of fire drills in any gathering. Could you elaborate on that?
Yes, sure, sir. You have touched my nerve on that, actually.
Another thing that I don't see in this room are any fire sprinkler systems. I don't know why.
No, they are concealed fire sprinklers.
They are concealed ones.
They might not actually be operational. Yes, exactly. But right. I don't bother about that. I would bother about Bisleri not kept over at my table. You know, that is what I would bother about. Right, sir. So coming back to the fire drill thing, I will share a small example. A manufacturer supplied hoses, UL-listed hoses, beautifully done, and right to the best of the specifications. Those hoses were non-percolating hoses made of rubber, right? For 6 months, the operational guys, they kept those hoses stacked beautifully, nicely done in the packing. No fire drill ever done. Never bothered to take them out or use them. So one fine day, a fire occurs. They come out and they plug in those hoses, and by that time, the cracks have developed and the hoses were leaking. And when you actually face these sort of situations, who's to blame? It's very easy to put on the blame. The onus finally comes on to the manufacturer. And the manufacturer would say, I mean, my SOP told you clearly, you know, you have to maintain these hoses, you have to use them once in a month, flush them down, dry them, roll them, and keep them. That's how it is going to work. So drill, if you are, see, both scheduled and unscheduled drills are very, very important, sir. So when you talk about scheduled drills, yes, of course, I am putting, if I have some new technology which I want to incorporate in my system, or a new design feature which has come up, or a new disaster management technique which I want to portray, have a drill which is planned. But then please also do have unscheduled and unplanned drills, because they are the ones who are really going to give the critical aspect of how we stand and where we are actually. And post-drill evaluation is actually of a very, very important factor, that yes, this is what we have learned, this is what is a takeaway from the drill which we conducted. Thank you.
Yeah, just designing the building to be fire safe is not enough. Post construction, post occupancy, the fire drills play an equally important role. Coming back to materials, my question to Rahul Gupta, could you shed some light on certification and standards which are globally recommended for buildings from the material side?
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. It seems like, before I give answer to you on that, it seems like I just felt 2 minutes back that I have got somebody taking my notes and speaking on my behalf. Mr. Rizvi did exactly the same. Just to let you know, I'm very, very passionate about fire. I'm not as eminent in my experience as the panelists here. They design, they know much more about technicalities of the products. But fortunately or unfortunately, I come from both sides of the fire. So I come from the background where I manufactured my products, which were fire rated and things like that. And I come from a background where I do the service. That means I do the testing and certification for the fire products. My personal experience, and why I say that exactly, in the morning when I came, I asked a very simple question, and we just said about car. In the morning, I asked just one of the persons here, who is the most important person in your life at your home? And the person says wife, and said, where does that lady spends most of the time? In kitchen. I said, what do you use? Cylinder. What are the arrangements you have done if there's a blast? Today, a cylinder guy comes into our house and he fixes the cylinder. I still see that jab log usse poochte hain leak ho raha hai kya, bolta zara dena matches ki tili, wo laga ke wahan check karta hai ki leak ho raha hai ki nahi ho raha. That's the kind of attitude. I think the most important thing before we talk about certifications and fire testings and all the big products being manufactured and the design happens, I think everything will fail unless and until you don't have the right attitude. As he mentioned, I asked Divesh from Aludecor, in this room, where is the fire exit? He shows me one, because I'm too passionate about these things. I said, where's the second one? He says, behind here. Now look at that. Now, you know, we are sitting into a fire seminar. We are talking about it. I think I'm very sorry before I start to talk about it. I just want to say one more thing for all of us. We are here. We are trying to tell everyone to change attitude. I think we have to start from here first. I think it's a very, very important thing we are discussing. We can leave for a couple of hours our food. We can leave a couple of hours of our selfies. And we can leave a couple of hours of our chit-chat, which we keep doing. I've been seeing. I was very tempted to go when Mr. Singh was actually presenting. I was very tempted to go in front of him and tell everybody out there on the backside to shut up. Because we are talking about the future. We are talking about the safety of ourselves. In this room, if we are just talking because Aludecor has kept one seminar here for the sake of it, I think it absolutely kills the purpose. We should not be doing that. Now, coming to the point now, I think it's very important. What I've seen is everybody talks about fire-rated products. I see most of the companies day in, day out. They say, even though they have no clue about what is the fire rating or a standard, they still say, because somebody has told them or an architect would have told them, A2 category hai ya B category hai, ab wo dimag mein baith gaya, and he will say, I produce A2 category product. If I ask him, what is A2? No clue. Somebody comes and says, oh, I have already developed an A1 category product. I asked, did you do the testing or certification? No. How do you know it? Google mein search kiya tha, corrugated sheet ko do aluminium sheet ke beech mein laga do, to wo A1 ho jata. I said, what about the bonding agent? What happens to that? No answer to it. Expansion of the corrugation inside is different from the expansion of the 2, 3mm or 0.3 mm aluminium sheets top and bottom.
What happens? No answer.
So I think it is very important for all of us that one thing I would also like to say, that we should not reinvent a lot of things when it comes to our codes and building things, because they are already existing there. I think the most important thing is to implement. It is very important that we should not only, and it would go to all the architects, consultants, and the end users like me, we should not talk about only testing. I think when we talk about testing, we are not too sure whether the testing of a product done by an X manufacturer actually suffices it. And one of the reasons for a big fire in London is that. When it comes to certification, it means we are talking about right from the process of procurement of your raw materials to the end user point. So there is a audit which happens on a regular basis. There are very stringent criterias for you to pass a certification, and then it makes sure for the end user to understand that the product which he or she is using or is going to use in the whole production complies to that standard. When it comes to testing, my personal experience, there are people from the facade industry, I would not like to name, came to me because finally you are the third party authority at some point of time when Mr. eminent guys like Mr. Singh will say, go to Element and get the testing done. They get under a lot of pressure and they come and say that, boss, maine toh abhi tak production shuru bhi nahi kiya, but I have brought sheets from China. Test kar do, A2 aa gaya ya A1 aa gaya ya B category aa gaya, I will start to sell, doesn't matter. I think there we all have to put our foot down, even the designers, to case, go ahead and say that, forget about your testing. Get the bloody certification done and talk about it. So that's very, very important.
Thanks. I think the issue of certification and what IIT Gandhinagar is doing, or what Mr. Khurana is doing in setting up standards, is going to go a long way in setting these standards. These standards that you talked about, A2, A1, could you just briefly highlight a bit more about what these are?
I think the we should not be too much bothered about the standards in terms of the nomenclature. I think it is more important to first understand what are your requirements, because there are a lot of factors which will come into picture where, you know, everybody right now has started to talk about A2 fire rated facade. Why? Why not B? Because if you say B does not have a flashover, again, if some product has got a B category, it doesn't have flashover, right? It burns, but it doesn't have a flashover, which is a very important thing in the behavior of a fire. Now the question is, why we talk about it? Because wo race lag gayi hai. Ek ne A2 kara diya, abhi sabko A2 karana hai. And nobody talks about, as Mr. Singh again said, and other presentations also talked about, is it a high-rise building? How tall that building is, where that building is it an exclusive building or is it in a public area? What are the facilities of active fire systems? I'm not talking about sprinkler systems or smoke detectors. We are talking about the fire brigade system. How much time in that particular area it takes for them to come in? There are a lot of factors which come into picture, whether it is an outside or inside, how much of population you will cater to in that building or in that arena. A lot of factors come into picture before you decide whether you want to go with an A2 category or A1 category. There are a number of standards which are available. Our building codes have much stringent standards. You have British standards, you have European standards, you have EN standards, you have American standards, and they are pretty good standards to comply with. But the important thing is not only standard. I think the important thing is the usage and the various factors which come into picture while we are designing it to finally understand whether you really need a B category product or an A category product.
I think we've heard a lot of views from our eminent panelists. I think with this, we will end today's panel discussion. It's been a very lively this thing. Over to organizers.